here, and I'm so grateful to Bill Alves for hosting this concert. It's a real privilege, and your book is coming out very soon, biography of Lou Harrison that he wrote with Brett Campbell, and it's just a fabulous work of scholarship and research, but also just so exciting, you can't put it down, very gripping, and full of great stories. And I've learned so much just in the last 24 hours being here and talking with Bill about Lou Harrison and his circle. And I wanted to call this program Lou Harrison and His Circle. We talked about this because, of course, Lou Harrison didn't write in a vacuum. He was a very social person and had his group of friends and colleagues, and they played music for each other and shared their projects and ideas. And so this is just, but then we went back and forth about composers, and there was Merton Brown and Ben Weber and all these other composers, but it would have gone on, it would have been a real marathon day lasting hours and hours, so we've cut it down a little bit. We'll start with two pieces, go kind of chronologically, and start with two pieces that Lou Harrison wrote when he was very young, and he did colored pencil drawings for them. And these came from the Mills College Library. My friend Steve Cowart Xeroxed them. And he was, I thought he was 22 years old. I thought this was from 1939, because it says, the score says 1939, but you think it was maybe earlier. So he was 22, studying with Henry Cowell, who is a great musical hero of the 20th century. We'll talk about him a little bit later, but so his mentor and teacher, Henry Cowell, was in San Quentin at the time, and I find it very, very poignant that he pays tribute to Henry Cowell with so Cowell, when he was a young boy, a teenager, invented these techniques. He was self-taught at the piano, so he just played the way he thought the piano should be played. So, this is about two octaves long, and thank you. So the first movement begins with clusters of groups of five and then groups of four in your left hand, and then in your right hand you play big groups of three, big groups of five going over the bar line, and anyway, it's a sort of complex piece, but it ends up not sounding so. I don't think he wanted it to sound like Elliot Carter, kind of, where you you count down to the last microsecond. And this second movement is starts out 13 against 7, and then 11 against 8, and then 11 against 6, 13 against 8, and so on. And the final movement has your right hand in 3, your left hand in 5, and then going halfway, then your right hand takes over 5-4, your left hand is in 3-4. But it doesn't sound like that necessarily. So this is Rhythmicana in 3 movements by Henry Cowell, 1938.
Thank you.
next are the exquisite corpse pieces that are that Bill. Are we doing Beyer next? Yes, we're doing Beyer next. Okay. Johanna Beyer, a very interesting composer that Cowell dedicated that piece to. She was a great advocate for Cowell during his years in prison. She was worked as his assistant, secretary, and was a really amazing composer. She wrote sort of enigmatic piano music. She wrote early percussion music, very experimental. What else?
Electronic
music, yeah. So she was really adventurous, and this is from a series called Dissonant Counterpoint, which is a method first, I think, introduced by Charles Seeger, who was Henry Cowell's first kind of formal teacher. The idea that counterpoint needed to evolve beyond, how would you describe dissonant counterpoint? Evolve behind beyond consonant counterpoint. So I'll play two of these pieces by Johanna Beyer, published by Frog Peak Press.
Thank you.
her or remembered anything about her? And he said, no. Did you ask him about her?
I think met her in New York and remembered her as tall and mysterious, but he, at Cowell's urging, had written to her asking for percussion music that they could, Cage and Harrison could perform with their percussion ensemble. And she sent him a piece that was, that he described as pure outer space music. It was so bizarre. And it turned out to be too hard for them, so they never actually performed it.
So next we have in your program, you have some of the exquisite corpse pieces. They were published by Peters under the name Party Pieces. I guess Peters came up with that title, that Bob Hughes arranged for woodwinds. But they are, the originals are playable on the piano, and I apologize for the bad copies, but I went down to the, with Bob Hughes to the Lou Harrison archives in Santa Cruz and used my phone to make snap some copies. And on some of them you can see the folds of the paper. You can see the lines on the paper that you probably have in your program. And this is a game, I'm sure many of you have played it. Usually it's with like a person, and one person draws, you have three people or more, one person draws the head and then gives some necklines, and then you fold over the paper. Then another person draws a body, then you fold it over, that person folds it over, and the other person draws legs, draws some little lines for the legs. And then you get this funny result because nobody knows what anyone else is doing. So Lou Harrison, John Cage, Henry Cowell, Virgil Thompson, and a couple other composers did this. Can you tell a little bit about
that? It was like a party game. They would get together with some beer and a bunch of composers. One would start by writing out a measure of music. So if you look on one of these pages, one composer would write out a measure and then fold it over, and you can see the fold lines here so that only the last couple notes are visible, and then hand it over in kind of a round robin fashion to the next composer, who would look at those couple notes and continue it for another measure, and then continue the process. And when it was all done, they would take it to the piano and see what happened. Just a kind of game.
So they don't make a lot of sense as music because they're by different people. But for instance, I don't know if this one is reproduced in your program, but so John Cage would write, and then Lou Harrison, and then John Cage four beats of silence, and then Lou Harrison. This is the same three.
Seminar in the spring semester in 1943. And at the same time, a couple that he met were Peter Yates, who was a writer and a concert organizer, and his wife, Frances Mullen, who was a pianist who specialized in new music and invited Harrison to write something for her. And so he started fresh from this influence from Arnold Schoenberg, he decided he would write her a 12-tone suite, that is, using the Schoenberg famous 12-tone composition method, and also influenced by her formidable talent. But he was, of course, a 12-tone novice, and he started writing this movement called Conductus, which is based on a medieval kind of form in which there is this cantus firmus, this core melody. He thought that could be all of the different permutations of the tone row, or the initial, the 12-tone sequence of pitches. And he would write above that a series of variations. Well, he didn't get very far when he realized how tedious that had become, and that he was found himself making it more and more complex in order to relieve some of that, and just became an impenetrable thicket of complexity. The obvious solution was to go ask his teacher, Schoenberg. The problem was that he had been very bluntly warned that Schoenberg absolutely refused to look at anything 12-tone from his American students, and had sometimes thrown out the entire class in exasperation. John Cage, who'd also studied with Schoenberg, told him harrowing tales about Schoenberg's cruelty to students and such. But he didn't really have any other option, so he decided to take it into the class. Schoenberg saw it and knew right away what it was and what where he'd gone wrong, that it was 12-tone, and he didn't care. He just began telling him, your problem is that it's too thick. You need to start listening to Mozart. Everything has to be thinner. Only what's necessary. If a note isn't necessary, it shouldn't be there. And started telling him how to pull this movement together. And so with Schoenberg's help, it became a successful piece.
The row that repeats is on the downbeat of the treasure.
Thank you. Thank you.
suggested to Lou Harrison that he take classes from Henry Cowell at
at the UC Extension.
At the UC Extension. And Peter Cleghorn, his son, lives in Oakland, and I got to know him sort of separately from the whole Cowell and Lou Harrison story, and got to play some of Cleghorn's music for Fern Cleghorn, who lived with Lou Harrison in a kind of commune situation, the Cleghorns and Lou Harrison and others. So James Cleghorn has lots and lots of piano music that's completely unknown. He's known as the music librarian at San Francisco Public Library, right? And this is a piece, I'm just going to play one very short piece. This is Cyclus 18, and don't know what the year is or anything, but just James Cleghorn.
Exchange for writing some music for her. while she was away teaching at Bennington College. Her husband was Joseph Campbell, who was became a very famous author of and scholar of worldwide mythologies. Many of you may know of his name through these books or through the famous PBS series on his work with Bill Moyers. Cage and Harrison and Campbell and Erdman were hanging out all the time. Cage and Harrison were fascinated by these ideas of a kind of global mythological subconscious that that Campbell told them about, and these ideas also informed the different scenarios that Jean Erdman would write for her ballets. And so around this time, Cage wrote this prepared piano piece called The Perilous Night, based on these ideas of the hero bringing back something from an arduous journey of Campbell's. And a couple years later, Harrison wrote a ballet for Erdman called The Perilous Chapel, which was about the same thing. Cage wrote this orchestral piece called The Seasons, which was about this ideas of cyclicness in mythology of Campbell. And the next year, Harrison wrote the very same thing for another ballet called Solstice.
And they were also going through kind of difficult times personally, I think.
Yes.
And some emotional upheaval. I think both men in their life were sort of having some crises.
Yes.
So I think that that shows in the music.
So this was just a year before Harrison had to be kind of rescued by Cage and taken to a mental institution where he remained for a good part of 1947. Cage had just been, was confused about his sexuality and resulting in him being kicked out of the apartment with Xenia, and they broke up. And so that was all happening this year of 1946 when Erdman approached them to write new pieces for the debut of her new company. Harrison wrote Changing Moment, based on her scenario, and Cage wrote Ophelia.
Thank you.
played, and I think it's very much, he calls it a portrait of madness. And you think of Ophelia being tormented by Hamlet, and my daughter is in her first year of college, and I see friends of hers who are sort of kind of gaslighted by young men, or just sort of driven mad in different ways, and it's all a drama, and so I think there are many modern Ophelias. And it's, anyway, so here's Ophelia, 1936.
Thank you.
say something about Frank Wigglesworth.
Frank Wigglesworth was a native of Boston, but he was in New York at about the same age as Lou Harrison, and they became really close friends. They both shared a real interest in medieval polyphony and intricacies of counterpoint. One would write a fantasia for strings, and then the other would write a fantasia for strings, and they would sit around and discuss these things till wee hours in the morning. Harrison always thought of him as a very affable guy and was very affectionate towards him and his wife Anne.
So I got this for $8 online. Sonatina, just going to play the first movement, composed in 1988, as is the next piece we'll hear, Summerfield set. And it says, the sonatina says B plus B on the score, and then it says 4LS. And I've contacted a couple of Frank Wigglesworth's friends in New York, but they don't know who BB or LS is, so another mystery. So I'm just going to play the first movement of sonatina. Is that true that he didn't compose music so much for equal-tempered piano for a while?
Not so much, but occasionally he would, Susan Summerfield at the time was the chair of the Mills College Music Department and a pianist, and so she, when she was there, they awarded him the inaugural Darius Mio Chair in Composition at Mills in the 1980s. So it was kind of a homecoming to him, and he wrote this piece in her honor. And although it was 1988, the middle movement, actually he wrote when he was studying with Henry Cowell.
Oh!
So it comes from, it actually spans 50 years or so.
So there's like the second movement is a ground, and a ground being sort of like a chaconne where there's a recurring theme, right? Sort of ground bass. And then round for the triumph of Alexander is the last movement. And the first movement has an inscription by Lucretius about Mars lying on the lap of Venus.
Thank you.
hope you can join us for